Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
When I was young and foolishly pushing the misbehavior envelope, my mother used to warn me by saying, "You're cruising for a bruising." And I knew that I had not crossed the line as yet, but I was dangerously pushing my luck when she would say that. And in our story here tonight, we see that the great Apostle Paul, the Apostle of the Gentiles, was determined to have his way. You know, like we do. We're going to do it our way, we're going to have it our way, and bless God, no one's going to stop us. And Paul was warned about going to Jerusalem. But he had something in his mind. Now, sometimes the reason why we do certain things is because we're carnal. And we're going to dismiss spiritual things in order to embrace, put a big smooch and hug onto something physical, something carnal. But in this particular case, Paul has been warned about going to Jerusalem, not because he's carnal. He's not going down there to go to the circus. You know, they didn't have, what do they call that, Six Flags. They didn't have a Six Flags down there or anything like that. He wasn't going to Jerusalem for that reason. As a matter of fact, in Romans chapter 9 and verse 1 to 3, the Bible said, "I say the truth in Christ and lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart." This is Paul speaking. He said, "For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh." He was heartbroken over the nation of Israel. He knew that they were lost. He knew that they were going to die and go to hell. And it broke his heart to think that way. Why, in the very next chapter, in Romans chapter 10, in verse 1 and 2, he said, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved." He said, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge." He said, these dimwits, they want godly things, they want spiritual things, but they're going at it the wrong way. So Paul's desire to go to Jerusalem is because he said, "I got to get down there to, that's where the temple is. That's where the heart of this whole religious thing is." He said, I got to talk to my people. I've got to get them to see Jesus Christ as their Savior. So that was the reason, and he was pig-headed and obstinate. Well, I don't think you have many Jews being pig-headed, but maybe in this particular case he was being pig-headed. But he was definitely obstinate, and he's warned. And notice it talks about here, it says in verse number 2, "And finding a ship sailing over." So he jumps on board this ship here, and he's making his way toward Jerusalem, and he's cruising for a bruising. Literally. And I want to look at some things here regarding this and ask you the question tonight: are you cruising for a bruising? And so if we look at our text here, I just want to look at several things here throughout this course that shows us how God was dealing with Paul. First of all, we see back in Acts chapter number 20, if you look back there, and we'll read from verse number 18. It says, "And when they were come to him, he said unto them, Ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I had been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem." Notice that's a small s there. He said, "I go bound in the Spirit." That's his spirit. He's got it in his heart and soul that this is what he's going to do. He said, I'm going bound in the spirit unto Jerusalem and knowing the things that shall befall me there. I don't even care what happens. Save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. In other words, the Holy Spirit of God already enlightened him to the fact. He says, you know what's awaiting you, son? Bonds and afflictions. It's kind of like, and there's no evidence that the father of the prodigal ever gave him any warning along this line, but if the father had, who knows, maybe the young lad would have got to the end of the driveway and turned around and come back in. If the father had said, well, son, you know, you go down there to that far country, you don't think anyone's going to care about you down there, do you? And it's going to be hard, and you'll probably run out of dough before too long, and then you'll have to resort to this and that, and you're not going to have any friends, and why, you don't even have a cell phone. He could have told him all of those things, and maybe, just maybe, he could have said, you're going to go down there, and boy, you'll end up, I've known people just like you, you'll end up in a hog pen. But there's no indication that he ever had that warning. But the Apostle Paul had the warning of the Holy Ghost. Had the warning that said, you know what's awaiting you down there, Paul? Bonds and afflictions. And you know what Paul said? I don't care. I don't care. Well, I think a little later on, and we'll see, I think he did care. The Spirit forbade him to go. And before you and before I ever get off into things that we ought not to get in, I'll guarantee you, child of God, that the Spirit of God warns you. You may want to silence that thing. You may want to tell him, quiet down, leave me alone. But the Spirit of God that indwells you, if you're saved, warns you. You ought not to be doing this. This is trouble. You know how this is going to go. And because you've got that inner witness inside of you. And I'll tell you what, I believe even for lost people, I believe that the Spirit of God, you know, back there in Noah's day, the Bible said that my spirit, God speaking there, he said, my spirit shall not always strive with man. Now, there were no born-again Bible-believing Christians in those days. But the Spirit of God was trying to get those folks all in Noah's day. Listen to that guy over there. He, you better get on that boat. Well, not really a boat, but you know, people relate to that. Get on that ark. Get on the ark. That's your only hope. And so they were warned. In Isaiah 30 and verse 21, the Bible said, thine ears shall hear a word behind thee saying, this is the way. Walk ye in it. When you turn to the right hand and when you turn to the left, the Spirit of God, and you know you've heard that voice. You know you have, where you want to go this way. You want to go to Jerusalem. And he said, don't go there. And for us, it's not Jerusalem. Who knows where it is? And the Spirit of God saying, you don't need to be going there. You need to stay clear of that. And you hear that. You hear it. Oh, maybe it's not audible. But you're nudged by something, and you know it's the Spirit of God. In John 14, 26, the Bible said, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. And you know you've heard verse after verse after verse about all kinds of things, the places to avoid, the people to avoid. And about the time you're thinking of joining right in and hopping in and being a part of, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit of God, the Spirit begins to forbid you and say, don't do it. You know, and all of a sudden verses that you've long forgotten and hoped were removed from your King James Bible that are still there start coming to mind again. In John 16, 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you in all truth. And he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Kind of like, I'm going to show you that bonds and afflictions await you. Yeah, and so are you cruising for a bruising? You're cruising for a bruising tonight if the Spirit of God is forbidding you to do something or to go somewhere, and you're saying, I'm going anyway. All right? You can ignore. You can ignore the internal witness that God has put inside of you. It's over in Acts chapter 21 and verse number 4. It says, you know, after they had jumped on the ship here, they're already sailing, they're already cruising. And finding disciples, we tarried there 7 days, who said to Paul through the Spirit that he should not go up to Jerusalem. Now we have the disciples. The disciples forbade them from going. Now, and we're even told that these weren't just wayward friends. They did it through the Spirit of God. These are good, godly, we'll call them good, godly Christian friends. Warned them. Paul, don't do it. Don't go there. Says specifically through the Spirit that he should not go up to Jerusalem. And I don't know if they offered him any of the wherefores and the whys and all, but perhaps they did. And maybe you've thought about doing something, going somewhere, being with someone, and the Spirit of God said, you're cruising for a bruising, son. Don't go there. Daughter, don't go there. And you're able to get beyond him. And the next thing you know, you run it by. We like to do that. We like to run it by some friend, one of our co-equals, you know. Yeah, I've been thinking about doing this. What do you think of that?
Ooh, boy, I'll tell you. You know, a verse of Scripture immediately comes to mind. And, as your friend, I think I ought to tell you that.
And all of a sudden you realize, see, because we try to seek out friends, and mark it down, folks, people that tell you what you want to hear are not your friends. I don't know what they are. They're your enemies, actually. Sometimes, folks, it takes, a friend loveth at all times. A friend loveth at all times. And somebody that loves you is not going to let you hurt yourself. They'll warn you of it. The Bible says in Proverbs 1 and verse number 5, a wise man will hear and will increase learning, and a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsel.
Oh, I knew you were going to side with that Bible.
No, I'm actually siding with you. I'm taking your best interest at heart here. So we start off and we see the Apostle Paul. He gets an actual witness from the Holy Ghost himself that says, don't do it, Paul. Warning you right now, bonds and afflictions, they're abiding you down there.
Bah. Bah.
I know, I'll go talk to my friend Bubba. Bubba always tells me what I want to hear. Proverbs, all of these verses are in the book of Proverbs. Well, I'll tell you, it would do us well. You want to be a friend? Get some of these proverbs down in your gut so that when your friend comes, you can help him. You can be a real help to him. The Bible says in Proverbs 11:14, where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. See, a good friend will keep you safe, keep you from harm's way. Proverbs 12:15, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise. They're not trying to lead your life. They're not trying to ruin your fun. They're trying to help you. They know, hey, sometimes what you need, you have to get beyond the blinders that you have on, and you need someone to stand back and have an objective look at what you're doing, what you're thinking about doing, who you're going with, and all those kinds of things, and say, you know, do you ever look at it like this? Do you ever think about it like that? Because we don't. We see the end result. We see what we want, and that's the goal. That's the finish line, and we don't see anything. We're blind to everything else. Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, purposes are disappointed, but in the multitude of counselors they're established. Proverbs 20, verse 5, counsel in the heart of a man is like deep water. But A man of understanding will draw it out. Man of understanding will draw it out. Proverbs 20 and verse 18. Every purpose is established by counsel, and with good advice make war. Proverbs 27, 9. Ointment and perfume rejoice the heart. So doth the sweetness of a man's friend by hearty counsel. You get good advice from a friend, from a Bible-believing, spiritual individual, and I'll tell you, it will rejoice your heart. How many folks have experienced the heartache of psoriasis? No. The pain and itch of hemorrhoidal tissue. No. I'm watching too many commercials. But they've gone places, they've done things, they've been involved in things, and somebody, the Spirit of God warned them, a friend or a parent or a valued teacher, counselor of some sort, said, you ought to think about this, and they just ignored it and ignored it. And that's exactly what Paul did. He just keeps on sailing. Sailing, 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 cruising for a bruising. And then we see in chapter 21, look over in verse 10. Well, it says, and as we tarried there many days, there came down from Judea. See, it took God a little while to send some reinforcements in. There came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. And by the way, if you go back to Acts chapter 11 and verse 28, you'll find that he was a real deal. He's not a phony one. See, a lot of times they'll say, well, see, he didn't know, he wasn't, see, can you imagine this prophet trying to tell the great apostle Paul what to do? And so they make, some of these liberals make it out to seem like, well, Agabus didn't know what he was talking about. No, he knew exactly what he was talking about because God sent him down there. And when he was come unto us, he took Paul's girdle. Now, you know that a girdle is like a belt, right? And bound his own hands and feet. Giving him a visual illustration of what's going to happen here. And said, thus saith the Holy Ghost. By the way, you search your Bible all through the Old Testament. When a prophet spoke, that's how he began. He would say, thus saith the Lord. And boy, your ears were expected to perk up when he said that, because that was the catchphrase. If he didn't say that, then you might have had a false prophet on your hands. But when they prefaced their statement, their dictate with, thus saith the Lord, or thus saith the Holy Ghost, you do well to listen. So shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle. Now, bear in mind, he takes Paul's girdle from him, does this, and he said, you watching this, Paul? Yeah, what are you doing? And he binds up his hands and he said, this is what the Holy Ghost told me to tell you. The Jews at Jerusalem are going to bind the man that owns this girdle. You own this girdle, Paul? And shall deliver him unto the hands of the Gentiles. And when we heard these things, both we and they of that place besought him not to go up to Jerusalem. Here's Luke writing this, and he says, wow, when we heard Agabus say that to Paul, I mean, we were shocked. Can you imagine taking Paul to task like that? And telling him that, and when we heard that, boy, we were shocked. And we too, we said, well, Paul, don't go. Whatever you do, don't go. That would be crazy to do that. And then Paul answered, he said, what mean ye to weep and to break mine heart? I'll tell you, if the Holy Ghost doesn't get your attention and you poo-poo him and you dismiss him and your friends and parents and spiritual influences in your life come and they try to talk some sense into you and you dismiss them, and then the preacher stands up, and the preacher bellows out the message and the warning, and you say, well, he's not talking to me. Must be talking to him over there. Don't do it. The Bible said in Hebrews 13 and verse number 7, remember them which have the rule over you and have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. I mean, if they're not an example or an example to you of what, you know, I mean, if I'm preaching this message to you from jail, then you might want to question, well, I don't know that he's got a whole lot to say. But check out my conversation. Check out the end of my conversation. Is there any validity in what he's saying? Hebrews 13, verse 17, obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls, as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. See, when I warn people about certain behaviors and all that, it's not because I'm going to personally gain anything by it. I'm looking out for your soul. I want to be able to give a good report of you. But if you poo-poo me, see, I'm powerless to live the Christian life for anybody else. I can stand up here and I can quote verse after verse and give you example after example, and I can live the most godly life imaginable that flesh and blood could actually live. But if you don't do it, I have no power to make you do it. Other than to simply say to you that one day you're going to give an account for it, and if you haven't done what was right to do, that's not going to be profitable for you. So what was Paul's response to all the counsel? What was his attitude toward the godly advice? What value did he give to that still small voice? We read it there in verse 13. You're breaking my heart. You're breaking my heart. I want to do this. That's his attitude, and that's our attitude. Why is everyone telling me not to hang out with that person? Why is everyone telling me don't go there? I'll tell you why. Because they know that it's the right thing. But if you've already got it in your mind, that's what I want to do, then you'll receive all of that, not as good news. You'll tell you like, you're breaking my heart. I want to hang out with those derelicts. I want to go to that place where it's all bad influences, but I'm a Christian. I'll be okay. I'll know when to get out. I'll know when to come home. I'll know what to do if this happens or that happens. Notice, by the way, that response of the Apostle Paul occurs in verse number 13. Just a coincidence, I suppose. The proof text to disprove that Paul was not out of the will of God is in Acts 24 and verse 16, where the Bible says, and herein, Paul speaking, herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. So people, liberal theologians, and people that just want to have it their own way, grab Acts 24, 16, and as you see, Paul said he didn't. His conscience was void of offense toward God and toward men. But you know what I did? I read that verse very carefully. And Paul never said that he had a conscience that was void of offense. It's not what it says. He says, and herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God. He said, I'm always working toward that end. But he never says in that verse that he didn't have a conscience that was void of offense. It doesn't say that. You can make it to say that if you care to. But he didn't say that. He says, I'm exercising myself to that end. I'm working toward it. I bless God, I don't want to be an offense to God, and I don't want to be an offense toward men. But if the truth be known, see, because he's going to dismiss this little episode here. That the Spirit of God said, Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. And all his friends, all his godly disciple friends said, Paul, don't go to Jerusalem. And then the preacher got up in his face and said, Paul, don't you go to Jerusalem. And what's he turn around and do? Goes to Jerusalem. God says, when that happens, you're cruising for a bruising, son. And so in Proverbs 29, verse 1, he that often, that being often reproved, hardeneth his neck. It's like, shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. You've seen that done. You've probably done it yourself. All you know that the Word of God, the Spirit of God is saying, don't do it. Some friend or parent or relative, or don't do it. And we just tense up and we just say, everyone's against me. No, they're not against you. They're on your side. Then the preacher gets up and it's like, I'll just go to church. That's what I'll do. And he gets up and he preaches a message about the very same thing. And you are, get me out of here. You're cruising for a bruising, son. See, God's been trying to deal with you, trying to deal with you, trying to deal with you. And all the city was moved, and the people ran together, and they took Paul and drew him out of the temple, and forthwith the doors were shut. And as they went about to kill him, tidings came unto the chief captain of the band that all Jerusalem was in an uproar, who immediately took soldiers and centurions. They got to call out the National Guard to save Paul here. Ran down unto them, and when they saw the chief, when they saw the cavalry coming over the top of the hill, they left beating of Paul. They left beating of Paul. You see, he was cruising for a bruising, and he got it. That's one beating he did not have to take. And you can mark it down right there. I've got that written right next to that verse in my Bible. One beating Paul didn't have to take, because he had been warned and warned and warned. And he said, you're breaking my heart. You're breaking my heart, folks. Can't you see I want to do this? Can't you see I won't have peace and contentment in my life? I won't find happiness until I'm able to do this. I want this. All right, son, but you're cruising for a bruising. One beating he didn't have to take. How are we cruising for a bruising tonight? Are we on the verge? Have you been warned by the Holy Spirit of God? Has the Holy Spirit of God said to you, don't do that? And you just said, oh, leave me alone. I'm going to talk to one of my friends, see what they think. Because really, I don't know, that voice, maybe that's the devil. You know how Bible-believing Christians, they think they're so spiritual all the time. They say, I think I'm under the attack of the devil. That's what it is. The devil doesn't want me to do this. I'm going to ask a friend. Of course, they never go and find a spiritual friend. They just find someone that is on the, you know, scraping the bottom of the barrel, spiritually speaking, and they ask them. Because they want them to say, no, I don't see anything wrong with that. You ought to be able to do that. That's good. And then one of those last resorts, you know, boy, waiting for, I'm going to start Monday morning. I'm going to start doing that. I'm going to go to church on Sunday, just to be sure. And the preacher gets up and he rears back and just lets it fly. And you go, oh boy, I really am under attack. Don't be surprised if by the end of the week, you're not catching a beating. And that's the question tonight. Are you cruising for a bruising?